You know, there are literally hundreds of experiments taking place on board the International Space Station, each and every expedition while the astronauts and the cosmonauts are up there. One of the most important lessons that the International Space Station is teaching us is how the human body actually reacts to being up there for up to 6 months. Whenever we take a look at going to Mars or going to an asteroid or those longer type missions, how our bodies react to those types of journeys is going to be incredibly important. We're here at the Cardiovascular Lab here at the Johnson Space Center. I'm joined by Stuart Lee, who is one of the lead scientists for this laboratory. Stuart, let's talk a little bit about, first of all, what this lab does, and then we'll take a look at some of these machines back behind us.
So the main objective of this laboratory, of course, is to look at how the cardiovascular system in particular responds to the effects of lack of gravity or weightlessness.
Right.
We're involved in several studies. One of the most important ones we're doing right now is an integrative cardiovascular experiment. Integrated cardiovascular experiment, or ICV, is a multi-center study headed up by Dr. Ben Levine at UT Southwestern and Dr. Mike Bungo at UT Health Sciences Center, in collaboration with Johnson Space Center and with the Cleveland Clinic, to give a good comprehensive evaluation of what happens to the heart in particular as a result of being in weightlessness.
So let's talk about it real basically. The heart's a muscle.
Yes.
Muscles react kind of strangely to being up in space. We're still learning kind of what happens. So
right.
Talk about kind of what we've learned about how the heart and the rest of the muscles react and what this ICV actually looks at and how it works.
So everybody probably has heard about muscle wasting or atrophy that happens in the skeletal muscles, in your, particularly in your legs and also in your arms.
Okay.
Same sort of thing happens to the heart. Most people don't realize that their blood actually has weight to it, and your cardiovascular system has to work in order to get blood from your bottom part of your body back up to your heart, and particularly to your brain.
Because of gravity.
Because of gravity, okay. Exactly. And so what we're looking at is because you lose those gravitational forces, it actually has an effect on the heart. That heart actually can get smaller as a result of not having to work as hard in space. So that's called cardiac atrophy. And what we're doing is looking at not just what happens with cardiac atrophy during space flight, but how it affects other things that you would normally do. Your blood pressure regulation when you're standing up, the exercise that you would normally do, or in the case of an astronaut, the EVAs that they have to do, as well as just the general function of the heart and the electrical conduction through the heart.
Okay, so let's talk about how you measure it. What does the crew do? We've got these two machines here, which are ultrasound machines, right?
Right, yep.
Okay, so let's talk about them.
So what we do normally is we look at, the first thing we want to do is look at the function and the size of the heart.
Uh-huh.
The way that you would do that scientifically is you'd use MRI. The other way that you can do it is an ultrasound scan. The ultrasound scan has the ability to have that device on orbit. And so we do measurements of the heart pre-and post-flight using the ultrasound. And you can see this is an image of the heart, actually some images that we captured early,
mm-hmm.
showing how the different ventricles of the heart and then and the atrium, and so how blood flows through there and how the heart actually contracts.
So this is actually what the crew member would see? Or
so
taking a look at it?
This is what we would collect on the ground. One of the neat parts of this experiment is that we actually collect the data on orbit. And rather than having the astronauts become experts in sonography, we have one of our experts, Mr. David Martin, who actually guides them on orbit how to do the ultrasound on orbit. And this is the device that we use for that.
This is the actual machine that's up there.
So there's one just like this on orbit. And what David can do is he can then tell them where to place the probe, how to angle it, because those are all very important things. And then he teaches them, tells them how to, what buttons to push in order to get the images that they need for the experiment. So that he's sitting in mission control, he sees the images they see, and he also sees them doing the work.
So it's not like they have to become a PhD or an MD to
right.
run these type of machines.
Yeah.
They just take some basic training, and then the ground teams can really kind of guide them through.
Right.
You know.
Yeah.
Now talk about the color. I find this kind of interesting because our astronauts are incredibly smart people, but this color coding, talk about it. It makes it a little bit easier for them to basically know which button to push. Right.
Right. So, you know, there's lots of different buttons on here, and they've got all their own little labels on it, and it means a lot to the sonographers, the people who normally do this stuff. But it doesn't necessarily mean a lot to, you know, an astronaut who hasn't had as much training. So David could say, you know, push pink number two,
mm-hmm.
and that they would know exactly where to go to it. This is a template specifically designed for this purpose by NASA to be able to do this sort of stuff. One of the neat Earth applications of this is that if you're in a remote environment, and you need an ultrasound, you could actually have a non-expert collect ultrasound in the same fashion that David or someone like him could guide them through the procedure and do a diagnosis where there isn't a doctor.
Yeah. So you could just get, this has applications here on Earth,
yes.
But you know, you're not physically there with your doctor or somebody telling you what to do, but you can actually kind of sort of, I think I could probably even figure this out.
It's a neat little system.
So talk about, you know, this ICV experiment. What have we learned about the heart? And you know, you said it gets smaller, but how do you combat that? Like, what would you do to?
Well, the best way that we know how, or the way we're doing it now, is with exercise. Mm-hmm. And so exercise on the ground makes muscles grow. It also helps the heart as well. And so we do the same sort of thing on orbit. The astronauts participate in treadmill exercise and cycling exercise, as well as weightlifting type exercises. And all those sorts of things are good for the human body. What we've learned so far is kind of interesting, that we expect there's a certain amount of individual variability among astronauts. Some people lose more, some people lose less. What's pretty cool about the preliminary data so far suggests is that the amount of exercise or cardiac work that your heart does on orbit is actually related to the amount of atrophy we see. So somebody who does a little more loses less of their cardiac mass, and people who end up doing less than they would normally do on the ground would lose more.
So there's a direct correlation between basically how much
exercise
you put into it. That's fascinating.
Yeah, the study's about halfway through, so we're still learning a lot, so I don't want to put too much stock in that.
It's been going on for three years?
3 years. We've got 3 crew members on orbit right now, and we've got a couple more after that. We should be done in the next couple of years, and we should be able to start disseminating the results at that point.
How often do they do this type of experiment? I mean, they're very busy up there, so how often do they actually, you know, work with this type of experiment, and how often do they participate in?
So we have a couple data, several data collections before flight, so we get an idea of what their heart looks like and how it functions on the ground, as well as we get an idea of the amount of work that their heart does using what's called ambulatory monitoring, where we measure blood pressure and heart rate throughout 48 hours. So we get a baseline of what they normally do, their typical day, and then we repeat that 5 times on orbit. So early in the mission, all the way to the end of the mission, we'll repeat those measurements of sonography and then the cardiac work measurements. The sonography, you know, takes them about half an hour, 45 minutes to do the measurements. We do it both at rest and during exercise. And then the other stuff that we call ambulatory monitoring, where they wear it's an EKG and blood pressure monitor, that they wear for 48 hours. It doesn't really interfere with their day per se. So they're able to do their normal activities, because what we're trying to capture is what they normally do.
That's fascinating. It's interesting that we're still learning about the human body and how it behaves up there, because it's quite different.
Right. There's a lot to learn, and everybody's different, and we're trying to figure out what the best countermeasures are to get us to Mars and to other planetary surfaces, so we can learn more about our solar system.
Thanks a lot, Stuart. We'll be back in just a few minutes, and we'll be talking about yet another experiment that's going to be on board the space station that the crew is going to be participating in the future, that uses the same type of equipment, and talk about what the purpose of that is. We'll be back in a few minutes.